The book of Ezekiel, chapter number 37. The book of Ezekiel, chapter number 37. Preacher, I'm glad you made it in back from your appointment. All right, good to have you with us this evening. I prayed for you today that the Lord would give you traveling mercy. And with your wife driving all the way to Johnson City and back, did you do all the driving? I was starting to say, if you didn't have heart trouble, you would have. Driving all the way back from Johnson City with a woman, I guarantee you. Yeah, I know it does. If you'll read Acts chapter number 27, you'll find it. The reason why that boat wrecked, the Bible said, and they let her drive. There was a woman driving that ship, and it totaled it out, bless God. They totaled it out, I'm telling you. And somebody said, you ever let your wife drive? One time. I got saved three times that day, decided I'd drive the rest of the way by myself. But I'm glad you're here tonight. How many of you are here for the first time in the course of this meeting? Look at our first time visitors. Raise your hand. Look at all of them. Isn't that wonderful? God bless you. Thank you so much for coming. I'm glad you're here and you've honored us with your presence tonight. Don't forget two more nights of the meeting as far as me being here is concerned, as far as we know right now. Tomorrow night, God willing, I want to deal with one of the most controversial aspects of the doctrine of salvation. I don't want you to miss tomorrow night. I never thought I would live to see the day that the very fundamentals of our faith would be drug out on the stage of debate, but that is being done. And so tomorrow night I'll be dealing with a subject that's very controversial concerning the doctrine of salvation. I want you to be sure to come and bring somebody with you tomorrow night. Maybe we can raise enough money this week to buy that fella a full-size guitar. I felt sorry for that fella playing that little guitar up here tonight. Big old fella like that playing a little guitar, my heart goes out to it. Maybe we can raise him some money. Look like an elephant playing a banjo up here. Maybe we can raise him some money and get him a real guitar. But I appreciate you being here. Did you know if I were to ask you that are church people, and by the way, Joey got saved last night, and it's good to have you back tonight. I prayed for you today, Brother Joey. Good to have you back in our services tonight. If I were to ask you, if the devil could do anything to destroy a church, what would it be? Probably, beyond the shadow of a doubt, we would probably say to bring division among the people. And God knows in the day that we're living in, I don't think I've ever seen as much division and fussing and fighting in our churches as I'm seeing nowadays. When I go to ordination meetings now and ordain young men to preach, I don't give them Bibles anymore. I give them whistles because they'll be more of a referee than they will be a preacher. That's exactly right. And that's the day that we're living in. But did you know that division is not a problem? Division is the results of a problem. I'm going to show you. Now, I'm aware of the fact that in Ezekiel chapter 37, I'm very well aware of the fact that God is dealing with Israel as a nation here. And I know that's the interpretation of these dry bones. But all scriptures given by inspiration and can be used for application. And in chapter 37 and verse 1, the hand of the Lord was upon me and carried me out in the Spirit of the Lord, and set me down in the midst of the valley which was full of bones. Now watch verse 2. And caused me to pass by them round about, and behold, there were very many in the open valley, and lo, they were dry. And verse 3, and he said unto me, Son of man, can these bones live? Now look with me in verse 7. So I prophesied as I was commanded, and as I prophesied, there rose a noise. And behold, a shaking. Now here's the division. And the bones came together, bone to his bones. Now I want you to look at something chronologically with me. In verse number 7, you've got the division. You've got the problem manifested. But before you've ever got division in verse number 7, you got dryness in verse number 2. And you got deadness in verse number 3. He said they were very dry, and he said, can these bones live? Let me tell you something. You show me a church that has division, and I'll show you a church that's got people that is drying up and dying on God. Now, brethren, I'm going to tell you, just because you have unity doesn't always mean God's in it. The Bible said in Acts 7, they stoned Stephen in one accord. Unity's not the answer. The answer is to get our people to quit drying up and dying on God, and then that'll bring the proper kind of unity to our churches. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm preaching to you from my heart tonight. There is a worldwide plague that has seemed to settle down in the fundamental movement. It is a drying up and a dying among the people of God. I wish you could travel with me for 6 months, Brother Michael. Some of you would learn to appreciate what you got here in this little old country church. Hey, I'm in churches so dead you can hear a gnat burp. I'm telling you, brother, there hadn't been an amen so long in them buildings. They'd die of a massive heart attack if somebody shouted the glory. When my boys were little, I taught them. I said, if I'm in a dead church and I'm preaching and nobody shouts me on, I expect you boys to kick in and help daddy out. Well, I forgot that I told them that. I was just joking with them anyway. And I was in a big old church down in Florida. It was dead. God, that thing was so dead. We were live on radio and live on television, and that doesn't mean anything at all to me. And the pastor was sitting there and his two associates and the song leader. There was Papa Bear, Mama Bear, and Baby Bear. And they were all sitting up on the platform, and the choir come out. It is the deadest thing. I never heard so much hooping and yelling. Sound like a bunch of chickens with a Pentecostal croup and all that high-pitched, highfalutin voice and all that choir. Just dead soul. That old doxology and all that other mess. And so when they finally got done, they gave me the pulpit. Well, I'm Phil Kidd the same everywhere I go. And I was a preaching and a slinging snot and a throwing sweat. And I threw my coat over one of them's head. And man, that crowd was sitting there with their mouth wide open. And about that time, my oldest boy was about 4. He remembered what I said about being in a dead church. Here we are live on radio and we're live on television. There's about 600 people sitting there, brother. And my oldest boy jumped out in the center aisle and went, "Woo!" Son, you talking about tearing the service up? One old woman's heart pacer went off so bad it opened up the garage door at the house next door. And brother, it blew that service up. My wife reached out with her hand and grabbed him by the seat of the britches and pulled him back in the pew and set him down. After service, he come running up on the platform and said, "Dad, pray for Mom. She's liberal like the rest of this crowd." And he just about told it right. But isn't it a low-down sorry shame that we drag in church acting like God died? I'll tell you something, brother. We've got it better now than we've ever had it before. We're wearing better clothes. We're driving better cars. We're living in better homes. We've got more money. We've been blessed more than anybody else. And you can't find a hallelujah anywhere. So I want to preach on the real problem of our churches. We're drying up and dying on God. I want to preach tonight for just a few minutes. Drying up and dying on God. I was home on a Saturday some time ago and I was working out in the room that I have in my house there and have double French doors like this. I've got a couple of horses out in a little old pasture back behind there that I bought. And I was working out and I looked out there and we call them old sucker trees down in Mississippi. They just grow anywhere. And I saw one of them growing out there in the field where my horses were pinned up. And I decided, Brother Junior, after I got done walking, before I showered, I'd go out there and cut that tree down. So when I got done exercising on my machines, I went out there and I took an axe and I cut that old sucker tree down. And when I did, it's standing about that tall. I just picked it up and threw it over the fence. And when I did, the way it landed, it looked like it was planted right there on the other side of that fence. It landed standing straight up. And I'm telling you, man, to look at that thing, you couldn't tell that I killed it. And like Baptists, you can't kill them sorry things. I'm going to preach on Sucker Baptist one of these days. And so, yeah, three of you are already confessing. So I got up the next morning, and I got on my machine, and I looked out there, and I said, "Man, that stinking thing's growing." And I couldn't believe it. And I went out there and I picked it up and it was just hanging between two limbs of other trees. And I threw it back down again. Did you know even though that thing was cut off, even though there was no life in it at all, did you know it was 4 days before that thing started withering and dying? I'll tell you what's wrong with our churches, brethren. We are living off what we used to be. We've been cut off from God for a long time. Now, we still stand the same. We still look the same. We want people to think we are the same. But in the privacy of our heart, somewhere down the road, we've been cut off from God. Now, I may not see it now, but you just hang on. My preacher always says, time will tell. Brother, somewhere down the road, you'll start withering away and drying up and dying on God. I'm going to give you a few points and I'm going home. Number one, why do people dry up and die on God? Well, if you'll study these valley of bones, and I don't have time to get into it, I got to roll. If you'll study these valley of bones, it could be because of the places you go. You know how many bones were dry in the valley? All of them. You know, birds of a feather do flock together. Hey, sir, you don't have to tell me how you're doing spiritually. You don't have to tell me that. Just tell me who your friends are, and I can tell you how you're doing spiritually. You tell me who you're hanging around, and I'll tell you how you're doing spiritually. And I don't care how saved you say you are, you hang around a carnal crowd, you hang around an ungodly crowd, you hang around that God-cussing crowd, it'll pull every bit of spirituality out of you. Hey, you'll never live for God. You'll never grow in the grace of God hanging around a crowd that makes fun of old-time religion. It'll pull every bit of power out of you. Some of you young girls will never be what you ought to be because of that freak you're dating that looks like he needs spray dipped and wormed. Looks like a family of kittens moved out of the seat of his britches. Looks like he hadn't had a bath since he's pronounced a human. Got his hair dyed to 7 basic colors. And you wonder why you have no joy in your life. You wonder why you have no power. You wonder why you don't get anything out of revivals. I'll tell you why. It's the crowd you're hanging around. That's why. You can't hang around that rock and roll crowd, listen to that ungodly mess running around half naked, don't go to church, make fun of the man of God. You can't run with that. And it'll make you dry up and die on the Lord. Amen. I decided a long time ago, I'm not hanging around anybody that pulls on me spiritually. I don't want anybody pulling God out of me. I want to be spirit-filled overflowing. And sometimes it ain't popular. But sometimes you even have to separate yourself from your own flesh and blood. I told my lost family, I said, you may go to hell, but you're not going to hell making fun of God and the Bible in front of me. You're not going to cuss God and drink your booze and lay all over my family like that. If that's the way you got to be, we'll just part ways. I'm not drying up and dying on God. Some of you are pushing your lips out, and I don't care. I'm telling you, that's why you've never done anything for God, because of the crowd you're hanging around sucks the power of God out of your life. You know, I stay in different motels every week. And we are plagued with Indians taking over all of our motels. Americans don't own motels anymore. They're all Indian-owned. If you'll notice, Indian women have that little thing, little dot on their forehead. Reason why they have, that's when you marry them, you scrape it off to see if you want a convenience store or a motel. That's why they have those. And I'm serious now. And so, I went into this motel, and Brother Allen got me a motel one time. Don't ever let Brother Sam Allen book you a motel. It was $4 a night, and I knew I was in trouble. $4 a night, they cost more than that to stay in prison. I called him back. I said, Brother Allen, is that including a mattress? Bless God, I pulled in this motel 3 o'clock in the morning and I had a sign, ring bell for service. I hit the bell and an Indian come up from under the counter. That sucker was sleeping under the counter. I like that, a massive heart attack when he come out of there. $4.99 a night. Spent $35 on Raid trying to kill the roaches. I was at Smith Motel. That's exactly where I was. I went and had a t-shirt made up. I survived the Smith Motel. So I was in a motel. Talking about losing your power. I was in a motel some time ago and they put me upstairs and it wasn't an elevator, a little Indian-owned place. And it's hotter than Dutch love, about 110 degrees in the shade. Sweat was pouring off of me. And when you live on the road months at a time, you have to take everything with you. I, I don't get a chance to go home a lot and change out. So when I've left home and never seen my yard for 9 months at a time. And so when I leave, I have to take all my books. I still study with books and everything, and I take all that with me. Man, I was up on the third floor of this motel, and there's no elevator, and it was all outside rooms, and it was owned by Pedro or somebody like that, and Pedro and Alberto, that was their names, and I knew I was in trouble, and I walked in there, and I said, I need a key to the room, and it was way up on the third floor on the backside, and man, I was in a rough neighborhood. And so I got all my books, and I had my hanging bag over my back, and I had all my suitcases. Man, I tell you, it's all I could do to carry that mess. And I went up three flights of stairs, got on the backside of that motel, last room on the corner on the far left, and I dropped all that stuff. I was exhausted. The sweat was a-flowing off of me. I took the key out of my pocket, and I put it in that sorry thing. And you know what he's thinking in? They don't give you keys. They give you these cards. And I put that sorry card in that door, and it wouldn't work. What more, man, it made me so mad. And I may have already, told this, Brother Michael, I've already told this illustration. And I threw it down. Did I already tell this illustration? And I threw my clothes down. I preached so much, I don't even know what I've told. You fool me, I'll cuss you out. But anyhow, I threw all my clothes down. I went back down to the front of that motel, and I told Pedro, I said, hey, give me a key that works. And I thought, man, I can't leave my clothes laying there. Somebody's stealing. I'm in this bad neighborhood. I went running back up here, got all my clothes, loaded them all back up, took them back down three flights of stairs, put them back in my van, locked the door, went back and got my key. Put my key in my front pocket, went back to my van, got all my clothes, got it all back on me, went up three flights of stairs. And I said, nah, I ain't doing this. I ain't dumb. I'm going to check that door before I carry all this junk up the stairs. So I go up to that door, brother, took that key out, put it in the door, and the green light come on. I said, now that's the way it's supposed to be. Put it back in my pocket, went down, loaded all that junk up on me again, walked up three flights of stairs. Under God, if I didn't get to the last door on the left, on the back side of nowhere, I put the key in that door, and that sucker would not open. I threw all my clothes down. Man said, don't leave them there. Somebody steal them. I said, I hope to God they do. I went back down. I said, let me tell you something, Alberto. You better give me a key that works or I'll steal your camel, bless God Almighty. So he swapped that key. You know how they do it in plastic cars? Gave it back to me again. He said, wait a minute. I said, where are you putting that key? I said, I'm putting it right here in my pocket. And I had my cell phone there. He said, oh, you can't do that. I said, what's wrong? He said, let me tell you something. When I swipe that key, I give it the power and the authority to open that door. But he said, if you put those keys next to that cell phone, he said, that cell phone pulls that power out of that key. And when it rubs together like that, it pulls that key blank. And when you get up there, it won't open the door anymore. And he said, you let that key rub up against that phone and it has no power. No doors are open. And boy, I got to walking up the stairs, Brother Michael, and I said, that's what's wrong with us. We come to church, we get fired up, God puts His power in us, then we go out and start rubbing around with the world, and we wonder why no doors are opened up. I tell you why, it's who you're running with. That's why you're drying up and dying. Amen. Drying up and dying on God, that's right. I'll tell you something, man, it could be because the places you go, the people you're hanging around. Hey, you might be drying up and dying on God, lady, because you've been poisoned by the devil. Amen. You got to be careful, brother, that the things come in your life are right and proper and approved of God. The devil will give you something that looks good and feels good, but after a while you find out down life's road that it's brought tragedy and misery in your life. What I'm saying is, if it grieves God, stop it. Why do people dry up and die on God? Number two, I'm losing some of you. You're withering away on me. Stay with me. How do you know what happens when somebody dries up on God? Let me show you what happens. Number one, carnality comes into their life. Things they were delivered from all of a sudden becomes tasteful again. When Israel was coming through the wilderness and they got dried up, you know what they said? With the God, we were back in Egypt with the leeks and the garlics and the melons. They started desiring that which they had when they were in bondage. Brother, when they got out and started drying out, the flavors and the lust of that flesh started to overwhelm them again. You know how I know some of you are drying up and dying on God? Because when you got saved, God gave you some convictions. But now you've changed your convictions. And things that used to be wrong, all of a sudden isn't wrong anymore. Things you used to wouldn't wear, now you're wearing again. Places you wouldn't go, now you're going again. Things you wouldn't identify with, now you're associating with. You know what your problem is? You've dried up and died. Amen, that's right. When you start letting things come back in your life, that's just a manifestation to God's people that you're dying on God. Carnality starts coming back in their lives. You know what's amazing to me? People think if they hide stuff from the preacher, they're hiding it from God. Let me tell you something, folks. You're not obligated to live right because of me. You're obligated to live right because you're a Christian. Don't try hiding your junk from me. The eyes of the Lord are everywhere, beholding the good and the evil. I was at a church down in Mississippi one time. There's so many men smoking out on the front porch you couldn't see the door. Had to have a foghorn to get in the church. I said, I'll tell you a bunch of cigarette suckers something. You ought to have more respect and suck that stuff out. I'm not talking about sinners now. I'm not talking about lost people. I'm talking about church members. I said, go suck your cigarettes across the street with the Church of Christ. Get out of here. You know, it takes a sucker to smoke. You ever thought about that? Think about that for a minute. Woo-hoo! Nice quiet crowd we got here in Tobacco Country tonight. So I'm tired of smelling like a cigarette by the time I get in the door. I want you to stop it. Go smoke somewhere else. Have more respect for God than that. Well, every night I was going behind the church. There was a gymnasium back there, and I was going back there to pray. And he's a good friend of mine. I love him. He loves me. But I ain't never seen a man love a cigarette like old Brother Steve loves a cigarette. Now, he's going to smoke till he dies, and he's going to die early. And if they're smoking in heaven, he'll have one that big around and 6 foot long. Never seen a man love to smoke like old Brother Steve. I love him, but he just will not. I've preached the hide off of him till I'm embarrassed. But I was back there in the gym praying, and he didn't know it. Well, when I told him to quit smoking out in front of the church, he come around behind the church to have a cigarette. He didn't know I was back in the gym. And man, he's a looking both ways, and he's a sucking on that thing. And you know how it is when you're in a hurry. You get that big red flame of fire. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Some of you is doing it tonight out there. Got that big red flame of fire. He's a toking on that thing and looking both ways, and I standing on the other side of that glass door. And I said, Lord, this may be sin, but I'm going to have a good time with old Brother Steve tonight. I let him get a big drag off of that thing. I come busting through those glass doors. I said, woo! Brother Steve, isn't God good? And he cuffed that cigarette and put it in his pocket. And he had just taken a big drag off of that thing. And I stopped and I said, ain't God good? He went, mm-hmm. And he thought I'd walk on. And I said, man, it's a beautiful night out here tonight. Mm-hmm. And man, smokes are coming out of his ears and he's a turning purple. I said, Brother Steve, has God been good to you? He said, I said, let me tell you what the Bible said. The Bible said to lift up holy hands. I said, brother, why don't you and I just lift our hands and give God the glory? And he looked at me and let go of that cigarette in his back pocket. Son, by the time he got both hands up in the air, that thing had burned through his BVDs. I'll tell you something. If you think Michael Jackson could do the breakdance, you ought to see Brother Steve with a cigarette in his back pocket. Hey, but I'm here to tell you, friend, the eyes of the Lord are everywhere. You don't live right because you might get caught by the preacher. You live right because you belong to the Lord. Carnality starts slipping back in your life. Confusion clouds your mind. Calamity is sure to come. So I said, well, I don't know if drying up's really sin or not, but I tell you what, you can debate that, but I tell you what it will do. It will eventually lead you into sin. You know, I was thinking about drying up and dying on God. I was thinking tonight, Brother Franklin, the people that were the backbone of the church when I got saved don't even go to church. I think of some of you old timers. I've been coming up in these mountains for a long time. Some of you know what I'm talking about. Some of the people used to sit on the front rows and carry their Bibles and shout. They don't even go to church. Some of the people 12 years ago in Cock County Fairground, when we had that tent meeting, the power of God fell. Some of those people that loved Jesus and testified and shouted and sung, they're not even in church. Their kids are on the streets. Their homes are blown all to pieces. I'm telling you, if you're not careful, drying up and dying on God will destroy you and lead you into sin. Dying on the Lord. May I say to you, I want to give you quickly my conclusion. I've got to close. I'm out of time. I want to show you the way to avoid drying up and dying. I don't want to be a used to be. I don't want to run from Christians when I see them because they remember how I used to love God. I want to die on the battlefield serving Jesus. I want to die with the joy of God in my heart and the peace of God in my soul. I want to die living for Him, brother. I'm telling you, when I draw my last breath, I want it to be for the honor and the glory of God. How do you keep from drying up and dying? Folks, we're living in a world and a society that is constantly pulling you away from God. The television, the billboards, everything, the school system, you name it, brother. Everything's pushing on us to tell us we're too busy for revival and we don't have time for God anymore. How do you keep from drying up and dying? Let me give it to you quickly. I'm going home. Number one, take full responsibility for the condition you are in. Like the old black preacher used to sing, it's not my sister and my brother, but it's me, O Lord, standing in the need of prayer. You say, oh, but now wait a minute, preacher, you don't understand. I'm like I am because of this or because of that or somebody did me wrong. Hey, let me tell you something, man. I don't care how wrong you've been done. We've all been ripped off. We've all had bum deals. We've all been taken advantage of. We've all been lied on. But I'm determined I'm not going to let them bunch of devils dictate my Christian life and get me to dry up and die on God. I'm not dying on God. Nothing would thrill that crowd more than to see you lose your joy and dry up and die. Bless God, you ought to keep your shout. Take full responsibility. Lord, I've allowed myself to get in this mess and I'm sorry. By the way, God already knows it. He's just waiting for you to confess it. I got an older brother. He was always a lot bigger than I was. I was skinny till I got saved. Got off drugs, started eating, got fat. Somebody asked me, said, how come most Christians are fat? I said, because when you get saved, you quit everything and eating's all we got left to do. Yes. And the Apostle Paul said to buffet the flesh over in 1 Corinthians. So we just become missionaries to the buffet bars. Don't laugh at me for getting fat. Bless God, we'll look at your wedding pictures too, buddy. But I always had a brother that was a lot bigger than me. He was a football player and I was a boxer. So I was a lot quicker on my feet than he was. But he was a lot bigger and stronger than I was. But I could get away from him. I was quick as lightning on my feet. He was just a big, burly fella. So I nicknamed him Fat Dog. God, he couldn't handle that. And he'd come out and I'd say, hey, Fat Dog! God, make him so mad. If he'd have got his hands on me, he'd kill me. But I knew that fat boy couldn't catch me. Man, I'd jump all around him. I'd spin around. I'd say, hey, Fat Dog! Son, it'd make him so mad. And he'd go out, you know, he'd come through the neighborhood and I'd say, hey, boy, you're not supposed to be out of the house without your license plate on. When you're that wide, you got to be okayed by the state. He told me, he said, one of these days I'll catch you and I'll beat you to death. I'm going to tell you what that low-down, sorry, wicked, sinful devil did one day. He caught me in the house. Everybody else was out in the yard. He got me by the neck like a chicken. He said, Fat Dog, huh? I said, hey, bro, I wasn't talking to you. Don't be jumping to conclusions, man. I was talking to that fat guy behind you. I don't think you're fat, man. He said, let me tell you something, you little scrawny punk. You're going to pay for that. Let me tell you what that devil did. He threw me down on the ground, got on top of me and took a pillow and suffocated me. And just before I'd pass out, He'd pull that pillow off my head. He'd let me get one good breath and put it back on top of my head again. He'd say, "Fat dog, huh?" And I'd say, "Oh, Chihuahua, you Chihuahua." Son, he'd give me those Indian burns. You know how you twist the skin? Man, he burnt the hide off of me. He grabbed my tongue, pulled it out of my head, let go of it, man. I mean, man, that sucker put it on me. When he finally let me go, I thought to myself, "I'm going to tell you something, fat boy. You're going to pay for this one of these days." Talking about your father seeing you. One day I went walking through the living room and my brother fell asleep watching television. And I saw that fat slob laying there. I got thinking of how he pulled my tongue, gave me them Indian burns, and almost suffocated me. I looked around, made sure nobody was in the living room. I had cowboy boots on, and I took one off. I held it by the leg part of that boot, and I looked around. Boom! I hit him right in the eyeball with the heel of that cowboy boot. I threw it over the television, and I jumped on the couch. Son, he come up from that floor. My mom and dad come running in. They said, "What's wrong? What's wrong?" I said, "I don't know. I was laying here asleep." He started screaming. "Must be having a nightmare. I don't know what's wrong with it." And all of a sudden, my mother said, "Oh, my goodness. Look at his eye. It's swelling out of his head." And I thought, "Yes!" Of course, man, they're doctoring his eye, and mom's putting ice on it, and I'm sitting on the couch. My dad comes over and says, "Phil, what happened?" I said, "Man, I don't know. I was laying here sleeping. There was a spooky movie. I must have had a nightmare, Daddy, and woke up." My daddy said, "I wonder how he blacked his eye." I said, "Man, I don't know. It looked bad to me." He said, "It is. It's pretty bad. It's going to be black for a while." I said, "Man." He said, "I wonder how that happened." I said, "Who knows?" He said, "I want to ask you a question." I said, "Yeah, Dad. What was?" He said, "How come you only got one boot on?" I said, "I must have been having a nightmare too." "Oh, was I about to have one?" He said, "Son, how come your other boot's on the other side of the television?" I said, "You know what, Dad? I'm about to figure this thing out now." He was laying on the floor having a nightmare. I was on the couch having a nightmare. I got to kicking my feet to get away from this big spook. And that boot flew off my... You know what, Dad? I bet when I kicked that boot off, it hit him in the eye and bounced over that television. My dad said, "No, let me get this straight. You laid on the couch dreaming you saw a spook. You kicked your feet. That boot flew off your foot. The heel of it hit him right in the eye and then flew back over that television." I said, "Man, ain't that amazing that could happen like that?" He said, "Now, son, is that your story?" I said, "Yes, sir." "Tell Jimmy I'll be praying for him." He said, "Now, son, there's something I need to tell you." I said, "All right." He said, "I saw you come sneaking in the living room, and I've been standing behind that door all the time." I said, "What'd you say?" He said, "I saw you come slipping through there, cutting your eyes both ways." And he said, "I stood behind the door, and I watched you look around, take that boot off, and hit that boy in the eye." I said, "No, Dad, you got it wrong." I said, "When I was kicking with that spook was chasing me, when I heard him scream, I saw my boot hanging out his eyeball, and I didn't know what to do, so I just grabbed it and threw it." He said, "Son, I saw everything." Now, I don't know how hard Daddy whooped me that day, but I remember the smoke alarm going off before he quit. He whipped me so hard. Somebody said, "Why did you dial 911? I wasn't able to dial 911. You know, we treat God the same way. We try to tell God the story when all reality, friends, he's been watching you all the time. Why don't we just come clean? Instead of getting a spanking tonight, why don't we just admit, Lord, we've dried up and we're dying and we've lost our joy. We don't shout. We quit testifying. We don't give out any tracts and we don't care if anybody gets saved. And we're just in a mess tonight. And if you'll be honest with God, I'll tell you what he'll do. The Bible said he will abundantly pardon. He'll forgive you and give you that joy you once had in your heart and life. Would you stand to your feet? I preached 30 minutes. I'm done. Would you stand to your feet? The invitation is starting immediately, my brother, drying up and dying on God. Drying up and dying on God. May I say to you, in an avenue of respect, he's been standing behind the door all the time. He knows the condition you're in tonight, sir. You're not fooling God. Oh, show me all your green leaves. Tell me how much you're growing. But God knows you're cut off. You know you're cut off. Why don't you just quit being a hypocrite about the whole thing? No telling what kind of revival we could have if we would get right with God. Somebody said, boy, I hope 40 people get saved. I hope 40 people get right.
Yes, sir. Amen.
Then the 40 getting saved will be an automatic reflex. Are you thoroughly right, or would you say, preacher, slowly but surely I'm dying? I was at a church the other day and they had live plants. I pulled one of those plants loose and stuck it back in the dirt. And even though I cut that thing off and it died, it wasn't until the end of the meeting until it started withering. You're cut off, aren't you? And now all you want to do is look real because you're not anymore. I got news, friend. You don't have to leave here like that. You're living beneath your privilege as a Christian. You can have that joy, that peace, and that zeal you once had in Jesus. And if you're not saved, you don't even know what life's all about till you come to Christ and profess Him as your Lord and Savior. I wonder tonight, what do you want, an invitation? What do you want me to do, beg you down an aisle, try to trick you to come? Forget it. If you're not willing to do business with God, I can't make you come anyway. But if all of us would take the plastic off and just forget about everybody around us and beside us, we could probably get some help in this invitation time. Some of you men probably need to get your wife by the hand and say, honey, we're dying. Let's not do this another day. Let's get right. Some of you young people need to go to your parents. You need to get one of these preachers, one of these deacons up here and say, look, I've dried up and died on God. I've lost my joy. I need help. I want that thing renewed. David said, restore to me the joy of thy salvation. Well, why don't you let God work a miracle in your life? Don't be a hindrance. And listen, if you continue to dry up and die, mark her down, it'll bring division in the church. It'll bring division. Would you be sensitive enough to the Holy Spirit to do what He's telling you to do right now? Would you obey Him right now? That's all I'm asking you to do. You may need to go to somebody tonight that you got hard feelings against. They may not even know what you're talking about, but you need to get that thing right. I want you to do it right now while we sing. I don't want you to bow your heads. I've got no questions. I'm not going to trick you. If you need to come, these altars are open. You say, preacher, if I come, people will think I'm wicked. I got news for you, sir. We're all wicked. The only thing good about us is what God put in us when He saved us. That's right, girls. Would you obey the Spirit of God on this first verse? Sing it, brother, right now. Would you come right now? That's right. Come on. Come on. Come on. Don't wait on anybody else. Doesn't matter what anybody else does. I'm talking about you obeying the Spirit of God. I'm talking about you not letting the devil let you dry up and die. Would you come? Come on, anybody else need to come? Come on. Drying up and dying on God. Anybody else? Preacher, I've lost my joy. I've lost my zeal. I lost my fire. Drying up and dying on God. Then why not tonight? Brother, will you sing a verse tonight of Just As I Am? I want you to get that ready for me. It's one of my favorite invitation hymns because I'm glad if you'll come to Jesus just as you are. You supply the sinner, Jesus will supply the salvation. In a crowd, look at this Wednesday night crowd. So I said, oh, people don't like old time preaching. Don't you give me that junk. Even sinners appreciate somebody loving them enough to tell them the truth. Old-time preaching's always worked. It always will work. Surely in a crowd this size, there's somebody here tonight. If you died, you'd bust hell wide open. You'd be in hell before they ever pronounced you dead. I've got good news. Jesus will save you tonight. He died on the cross for your sin. If you'll come tonight, we'd be glad to take a Bible, show you from the Bible how you can know you're saved. You need to be saved tonight. You know why sinners can come and enjoy our services and not get saved? Because they're surrounded by Christians that have dried up and died. And instead of being a tool that the Holy Ghost can use to work through, you've become a hindrance. You've quenched and grieved God. And now people will ultimately go to hell because we have dried up and died. If that's what you want, church, would you tell me tonight? Because I'm going home. I'm not killing myself for a bunch of people that don't want anything anyhow. I just soon go home. If you're here tonight and you're not saved, you need Jesus more than you need the next breath in your body. You need to be saved. While we sing this old hymn, "Just As I Am," you mean there's only 10 or 12 women that need to come tonight? You mean every man in this church is everything they're supposed to be? You lying, stinking hypocrite, you. I'll let your wife testify tonight. Some of you men need to get right with God. You need to be the example to your family. Need to get full of God. Get back on the front lines like you used to be. While we sing, will you come? If you mean business, I want you to come. Just as I am. You say, "Preacher, I don't even know how to be saved." If you'll come, I'll meet you here with the Bible. I'll show you from the Bible how to be saved. Would you come tonight? Is there anybody else that needs to come? Just as I am. Just as I am. Anybody else need to come? Preacher, I'm through. I'm done.